Okay. Rightio, I think, sorry about the late start. We didn't get a chance to set up until a bit late. Look, I'm Keith McKenry, and thank you for coming. Today we're going to do a second part of a celebration of this festival of the life and work of a bloke called John Meredith. Now, yesterday we did a concert in the Trocadero where we talked about John's life and we illustrated the life with some of the songs which were pivotal to his collection, because he was one of the world's greatest song collectors, not just in Australia, but on a world scale. And his biography came out late last year, and it's a good time for the National Folk Festival to celebrate. Today, we're not going to look at John's life. What we're going to look at are some of the songs and the tunes that he collected, many of which will never have been encountered by a festival audience before. John collected in two groups. In the 1950s, the seminal collection of Australian folk song was made predominantly by him with the early tape recorders. Then he got a heart attack and retired for 20 years from folk song collecting and started again in the 80s and 90s, assisted by the National Library. And today we're going to hear some of the songs which might not be as familiar to you as some of the, you know, the Ryback Shearers and Waltzing Matildas and Click Go the Shears type songs, all of which are important. But we need to celebrate the entire dimension of Australian folk song. And I'm going to be assisted here today by some wonderful singers and performers, many of whom have learned songs just specifically for this concert, and or have come to this festival solely to be on this concert and the one yesterday, not appearing elsewhere on the festival program. So they put a lot of effort into this work, and I hope you appreciate it. I'm sure you will. And I'm going to start off with Danny Spooner. Danny has been a great assistance to me as we've launched this book around the country in the last 3 or 4 months. Danny's come to many concerts and assisted in singing the songs. I'm really pleased that he's going to start the concert today. Now, when we talk about Australian folk songs, people think, okay, Rybucks, Shearers, you know, Bojangs, Bushrangers, Drovers. And okay, there's a lot of important Australian culture and history in those songs. But Australian folk song has much more dimension than just the ones which are recognisably smelling of sheep dip. You know, and this first song that Danny's going to sing is a song of the Napoleonic Wars. There were many songs written about Napoleon Bonaparte, and many of them travelled the world as broadsheets, and this is one of them. It was picked up, originally starting, I imagine, in the British Isles, and went across to North America and elsewhere, and found its way also to Australia. Now, the Americans are not defensive about calling American the folk songs which migrated from England and Scotland and Ireland. You know, no one says that Barbara Allen, for example, is not an American folk song, even though it started in Scotland in the 1600s. But in Australia, we're defensive about it. We don't say these are Australian folk songs because they're not about us. So here is an Australian folk song. It was collected in the 1950s by John Meredith, and again, it was collected in Victoria in the 1960s by a different set of collectors from the Victorian Folklore Society. So it travelled around Australia. It wasn't just a single incidence. So Danny is going to start the concert with this wonderful song, The Bonnie Bunch of Roses.
By the margin of the ocean, one evening in the month of June, the feather-nesting songsters, their charming note did sweetly croon. There I met a female, conversing in great grief and woe, conversing with young Bonaparte concerning the bonny bunch of roses. And out spake young Napoleon, and he took his mother by the hand. Ah, mother, pray. And in spite of all the universe, I've captured Bonnie Buncher Roses. Ah, son, don't be so venturesome, for in England there are hearts of oak. There's England, Ireland, Scotland, and their unity has never been broke. Dear son, recall your father in St. Helena, he lies low. You will follow after if you try for the bonny bunch of roses. Oh. He took 500,000 men and kings likewise to bear his throng. He was well provided for, enough to sweep the world along. Ah, but when he came to Moscow, he was overcome with the frost and snow. Moscow was ablazing, and he lost the bonny bunch of roses, oh. And then out spake young Napoleon, ah, mother, make my dying bed. Had I lived, I might have been clever. But when my bones do moulder, and the weeping willow o'er me grow, the deeds of bold Napoleon will prick the bonny bunch of roses.
Thanks, Danny. And there'll be a few contrasts here today, and the next one will follow Danny, because Danny is one of the true pioneers of the folk revival in Australia. He's probably been to more national folk festivals than anybody else, I guess. I don't know if that's mathematically correct, but I'd be put odds on it. And the next performers are some of the emerging performers in the folk revival. And I'm really rapt that they've agreed to be on this concert. They've learned these songs just for today. I hope they continue singing them after today. The Lucy Wise Trio is, I saw them yesterday in the Majestic and it was lovely. These are songs which are not ones which they're that familiar with. And so it's Lucy Wise, Chris Stone and Holly Downs. The first song was collected in 1954 by Meredith from Mary Burns in Sydney. And it talks about the wreck of the ship, the Dandenong, in 1876, I think it was, outside Jervis Bay. And so it's an Australian song through and through. The second song they're going to sing goes back to the 1600s. It's the classic ballad Barbary Allen, but it's the Australian version collected in the 1990s, just an inland from Eden in southern New South Wales. Now this song was not learned off Joan Baez. This song had been passed down through the family. This is a family version, the Bobbin family version, which was recorded in the early 1990s by John Meredith and Rob Willis. And so these songs have been alive in oral tradition since the early 1600s. There's a strong depth of songs still alive in Australia. So please welcome the Lucy Wise Trio.
It's so wonderful to be able to take part in this concert. And this first song we'll play, The Wreck of the Dandenong, is one that I've I remember listening to Kate Burke and Ruth Hazelton play this probably in the Butterwang, and I would have been like on the floor as an 11-year-old or something, just going, so those guys are kind of my heroes. And Kate Burke actually wrote the choruses to the version that we're going to play now. So this is the Wreck of the Dandenong. Oh, wild and furious blew the blast, and the clouds were hanging round. When the Dandenong from Melbourne sailed to Newcastle port was bound, she had 83 poor souls on. Through the storm she cleaved her way. Well, it's sad to relate that a terrible fate was just off Jarvis Bay. And I dream of you, I dream of sleep, I dream of being. But through the night I have to sail to brave this raging storm. Well, still propelling shafts gave away, and the waters they came crashing in, which filled them with dismay. All hands on board did all they could, till at length all hope was gone, and they hoisted signal of distress on board the Dandenong. It was not long until a bar of a risk and lively crew came bearing down, and the captain cried, "We'll see what we can." Sailors would those precious lives to save, and I'll dream of you, I dream of sleep, I dream of being warm, and I pray the sea will leave me be to see another door. Well, some in boats they try to reach that kind friendly bark, and numbers of their lives were saved, but the night came on pitch dark. What mortal man then could do more when the storm increased on strong, and the rest asleep in the briny along with the Dandenong.
And I dream of you. I dream of sleep. I dream of coming home. But a mile of water buries me beneath this raging foam. And I dream of you. I dream of being warm, but through the night I have to sail to brave this raging storm.
Thank you. So there's a lot of wonderful stories in these old traditional songs, and this next one is very much a Romeo and Juliet kind of a story. So it starts off with this young man saying, "I'm in love with Barbary Allen, and I've courted her for 6 long years. And she doesn't seem to take notice of me." And then he falls sick and is in bed, and he calls for Barbary Allen to come to him, and he wants to tell her that he loves her and wants to maybe see if a kiss from her would make him better. And she's actually says, "Well, no, actually, you've been a real scumbag to me these past 6 years, and you think you've been courting me, but actually you've been treating me really badly." And then he dies, and then she wants to die as well, and it's a bit of a sad story. It's a bit miserable, but we're going to try and we're bringing out the pretty melody of it. It's a beautiful melody. So this is Barbary Allen.
In England I was living, in London I was dwelling. I fell in love with a lady there by the name of Barbary Allen. I courted her for 6 long years in the hope that I might wed her. So ill that I caught the Barbary Allen. So slowly, slowly she walked in, and slowly she came nigh him, and all she said when she got there is, "I think, young man, you're dying." "A dying man I am not yet. One kiss from you might kill me. A kiss from me whilst in the garden walking, you picked a rose for the other girls, but none for Barbary Allen. Do you recall? For the love of Barbary Allen, they twisted and twined in a true lover's knot. For the love of Barbary Allen.
That was lovely, thank you. Now, in the mid-1960s, when I was a pimply teenager living in Dandenong, I went to a folk concert in the Melbourne Town Hall. It was the New Lost City Ramblers. And in the first half of the concert, they had a number of Australian acts as the support. And one of those acts was Alex Hood. And Alex's singing and his larrikin style was a revelation to me. The other Australian singers were okay. Leonard Orr Somerset was one of them. I think Gary Shearston. But Alex just stood out because he lived those songs and he made them come to life. And I suppose I owe a huge debt to Alex for inspiring me to be interested in Australian folk song. And I'm absolutely rapt that he's here today. Alex was a member of John Meredith's band, the Bushwhackers. And Meredith had collected a number of songs in fragments. He couldn't get the whole song, a verse here, a half a verse there. And one of these songs was a song called The Black Velvet Band. And he wanted to get the full version, he couldn't find one. And then Alex contacted him and said that he had found one. And so while Meredith collected this song, he collected it off Alex. Alex is the one who collected it in the field. Can you please welcome Alex Hood?
I'm only singing one song, but it's a beauty. And I heard this song because I went, when I was only 19, I finished my Nasho and I met a girl in Sydney and she came from Perth, so I chased her back. And she met me at the station with her fiance. So chastened I was, and I got a job working down the southwest part of Western Australia. And I finished up in a town called Northcliffe. And I worked for the Northcliffe Timber Mill, the Cowrie Timber Company, it was called. They owned the whole town. And one night in the boarding house, I was telling a few lies and singing a few songs, you know, and this bloke jumped up. I'd sung Botany Bay to them. And this bloke said, "Hey, my father used to sing a song a bit like that. Different words, though." And this is the song that he sang. Now, it has a really nice chorus, if you'd like to join in as we go. And the words are, "Her eyes, they shone like diamonds. I thought her the pride of the land, and the hair that hung down on her shoulders was tied with a black velvet band. Okay. Twas in the city of London, in apprenticeship I was bound, and many's the gay old hour I spent in that dear old town. One day as I went out walking along my usual beat, a pretty little young maiden came tripping along the street. Here we go. And her eyes, they shone like diamonds. I thought her the pride of the land, and the hair that hung down on her shoulders was tied with a black velvet band. One day as we went out walking, a gentleman passed us by. I could see she was bent on some mischief by the rolling of her dark blue eyes. Gold watch she picked from his pocket and slyly placed into my hand. I was taken in charge by a copper. Bad luck to that black velvet band. Oh, her eyes, they shone like diamonds. I thought her the pride of the land. And the hair that hung down on her shoulders was tied with a black velvet band. Before the Lord Mayor I was taken, your case, sir, I plainly can see. And if I'm not greatly mistaken, you're bound far over the sea. Then it's over the dark and blue ocean and a free trip to Van Diemen's Land. Far from my friends and relations and the girl with the black velvet band. Oh, her eyes, they shone like diamonds. I thought her the pride of the land. And the hair that hung down on her shoulders was tied with a black velvet band. Let's spin it again. Her eyes, they shone like diamonds. I thought her the pride of the land. And the hair that hung down on her shoulders was tied with a black velvet band.
Thank you. Well, actually, I haven't got time to do the Great Australian Whinger now. No, I'm sorry, just that one song. But he did ask me to tell you a bit how I got it and what happened afterwards. I couldn't read or play music very much in those days at all. And I remembered the song. I wrote down the words, but on the way back to Sydney on the train, I forgot the bloody tune. When I got back to Sydney, Mero got in touch and he said, "Hey, come on, you're going to come round and sing that song for me." I said, "I can't remember the tune." And he said, "Oh, well, take my advice," he said. "Have a shower." He said, "Nice and hot. Get in there under the shower and it might come back to you." Well, John was pretty wise. And I did that and it came rushing back into my head. So I rang him up and I said, "I'm coming now." Went round to his house and put the song down on tape. And that's the story of how John got the song. Okay. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you, Alex. Alex is at this festival. You should hear him. He's a true icon of Australian folk song. No risk at all. Here's another song which migrated to Australia as a broadside. And I'm really pleased that the next performer has agreed to do this for me. When you become a bureaucrat, your life changes. When you become an administrator, your life changes. When you become the director of a national folk festival, you don't get around to perform very much. And Pam Marigan has been a superb performer in the folk scene for a long time, And now that she's the festival director, she doesn't put herself on the program, so I've put her on.
I do.
With Norm, her husband, and Chris, the son, and James Palethorpe, she's going to sing for us The Rambling Sailor, collected by John Meredith from Sally Sloan.
I just wanted to say one thing. I had the great pleasure of meeting Sally Sloan when I was a young folk performer, and the John Meredith collection informed a lot of my early repertoire. I am a sailor stout and bold, long years I've ploughed the ocean to fight for my king and country too, for honour and promotion. I said, brother sailors, I bid you adieu, I'll go no more to sea with you. I'll travel the country through and through, and I'll still be a rambling sailor. And if you want to know me name, well, my name it is Young Johnston, to fight for my king and country too, for honour and promotion. I said, brother sailors, I bid you adieu, I'll go no more to sea with you. I'll travel the country through and through, and I'll still be a rambling sailor. And when we come to Greenwich Town, our lasses there were plenty. So boldly I stepped up to one to court her for my beauty. I said, my dear, what do you choose? There's brandy, ale, and rum punch too, and a lovely pair of new silk shoes for to travel with your rambling sailor. Now I rose early in the morn, and I left my dear asleepin'. I let her sleep for an hour or two, while I go caught some other. With my false heart and my flattering tongue, I'll caught them all, both old and young. I'll caught them all, but I'll marry none, and I'll still be a rambling sailor. To know me name, well, my name it is Young Johnston. I have a commission from the king to court old girls at Sanson. You can lay me down on the coal barn floor, and the wind and the rain blow between two doors. You can put him into bed with me, mother, for they tell me he's a rambling sailor.
Oh, look, thanks, Pam. It's a pity that Pam isn't singing as much on the tune on the folk scene at the moment because of her fantastic role as festival director. But can you give her a round of applause for being the festival director? And of course, the massive team which is supporting her. It's fantastic. This festival is a national treasure, I reckon. The next couple of songs are different because John didn't so much collect them as make them. He didn't write many songs. But here's one, the first and the second one he put the tune to. John Meredith was a lifelong student of Ned Kelly. And he wrote a book about Ned Kelly at one point. And it was a story about Ned as a young lad, about 8 or 9 years old himself. He saved another young boy from drowning in a river, a swollen river somewhere in northern Victoria. And the parents of the other young boy were so grateful that they gave Ned a gift, a magnificent green silk sash, of which he was always so proud. He was so proud of it, in fact, that the siege of Glenrowan, he put it on and wrapped it around his waist. And when he was captured by the police, they found it there. Now, Ned loved this story, and the sash got lost. It was stolen off his body at Glenrowan, and eventually all knowledge of his whereabouts were lost. But John sat down and thought the song needs to be written about this sash. So he wrote this next song, and I'm so pleased that Bruce Watson has learned it for this concert. He's assisted here, I see, by Harry Gardner and Mike Martin, is it? Yep. But so here's Bruce's take on John Meredith's own original song, Ned Kelly's Green Silk Sash.
Oh, I am a true Australian, you have heard me sing before.
Now I'll tell to you the story of the sash Ned Kelly wore. It was a present from a mother. Kelly saved her drowning son. As a token of her gratitude for an act of bravery done. Here's the chorus, when you learn it, sing it. Oh, where is the green silk sash that bold Ned Kelly wore? It's the colours of his father's land, stained with a hero's gore. Kelly wore it at Glenrowan, in the siege at Jones Hotel. Till cruelly wounded in the legs, to the traps at last he fell. Dr. Nicholson then dressed the wound in the railway waiting shed. And to his everlasting shame, he stole the sash from Ned. Chorus. Oh, where is the green silk sash that bold Ned Kelly wore? It's the colours of his father's land, stained with a hero's gore. Dr. Nicholson gave it to his son, who for Scotland soon was bound. But the curse of Kelly struck him down, in the Firth of Forth he drowned. Then a cousin brought it home again, for Ned's young brother Jim. But the sash was lost in Melbourne town, no, it never got to him. Oh, where is the green silk sash that bold Ned Kelly wore? It's the colours of his father's land, stained with a hero's gore. Oh, where is the green silk sash with its fringe of gleaming gold? Sure, it's tucked away in some old trunk with souvenirs of old. So come all you true-born native lands, a great search we will make, to find again the green silk sash, all for bold Kelly's sake. Oh, where is the green silk sash that bold Ned Kelly wore? It's the colours of his father's land, stained with a hero's gore.
Now, when John wrote that song, the first three verses were the truth, the known facts. The last verse he wrote about it being in someone's old trunk was his speculation. Imagine then his ecstasy when in 1973, many years after he wrote that, he did discover that an old lady called Mrs. McNabb in Rose Bay in Sydney did have the sash stuck away with old mementos. He brought it to her attention, the significance of it, and generously she donated it back to the Kelly country, to the Benalla Historical Society, which is where it is today if you want to go and find it. So that's Ned Kelly's green silk sash. The next song that Bruce is going to sing is another one. This one, the words came from a bloke whose pen name was a professor, Lancelot Harrison, wrote a little book of children's poetry called Tales and Taradiddles, which Meredith loved. And this is one of the poems in it, which he set to his own original tune, The Little Sparrow.
Thanks, and I have a special guest for this song because I was chatting on Thursday night. I met a fellow called Chris Sullivan, and Chris Sullivan collected with Meredith for quite a long time. And I mentioned that I was doing this song, and this is a song about a little sparrow and an emu egg. And Chris said, oh, I've got an emu egg, I'll lend it to you. And so I have the wonderful Chloe Roweth with a cameo appearance with Chris Sullivan's emu egg.
What a sparrow's in that.
Well, there was a little sparrow, and he was out of work. So he put his bluey on his back, and he set off for Bourke. He walked till he got bunions, then thought he would inquire, but found that he had only got as far as never tire. He was hungry, he was weary, he could hardly drag a leg, when suddenly beside the track he spied an emu's egg. He boiled it in his billy can and chuckled in his glee, while by his Waterbury watch he counted minutes three. And when the minutes three were up, he thought it time to stop. He took his little tomahawk and he cut off the top. It was a pity that he boiled it, it would have been much better fried, for as he stooped to sup it up, he tumbled down inside. And when he fell inside the egg, he to his sorrow found 3 minutes wasn't long enough, and the poor little chap was drowned. The moral of this story is, if emu eggs you seek for supper, you should take great care to boil them for a week.
Thanks to the wonderful Chloe, Mike and Harry.
Yes, good advice. Okay, moving on. Traditional carols are very rarely found in the Australian folk tradition, in the sense that they haven't been collected very often. Here's one which was collected by John Meredith and Sally Sloan, and it's only ever been found, as far as I can find, once elsewhere in the world. One version I found in an American collection. And we've got Christine Wheeler and friends, who are two of my friends too, Jane Thompson and James Rigby, live down the road from me in central Victoria. Mm-hmm. And they're going to sing two songs. Firstly, the traditional carol, and secondly, a song, I'll Be Old Smiles Tonight, which Meredith collected. This was sung by the Carter family, the original Carter family in America, find its way to Australia. John collected the tune as a dance tune, firstly, and many years later, the family members of the person who knew the dance tune provided him with the words. So now it's a complete song. So firstly, Christ was born in Bethlehem, and then I'll Be All Smiles Tonight.
Recording that Keith sent us a few months ago, I could just hear the ancientness of the carol. So we're going to do, there's only one way to do a carol like this, and that's a cappella. We're going to do a version that we hope brings out that feeling of the 1,000 years old.
And I had sung a lot of carols, but I've never discovered one previously that gives both the Christmas message and the Easter message. So it's quite an economical carol, this one, suitable for any church calendar occasion through the year.
Christ was born in Bethlehem. Christ was born in Bethlehem. Christ was born in Bethlehem. And in a manger lay. And in a manger lay. And in a manger lay.
Beale Smiles Tonight. It's sung by a very well brung up young lady. She has a broken heart and all she cares about is making everything okay for everybody else around her, including the fella. But what I have noticed in doing my own little bit of research into this song is how many different versions of the words there are out there. There's, I think, more than one Australian version and about half a dozen different American versions where it came from. So this is I'll Be All Smiles Tonight. I'll deck my brow with roses, but a false one will be there. And with the gems he gave me, I'll neatly braid my hair. I'll sing the songs he taught me without a faltering voice. Although my heart is breaking, they'll think that I rejoice. I'll be all smiles tonight, dear mother. I'll be all smiles tonight. Not even he who loves me will know my pain tonight. And when the room try to gaze upon her as though she were a charm. If he smiles on me, dear mother, as he used to smile on me, my heart will break with grief, but you'll find no change in me. I'll be all smiles tonight, dear mother. I'll be all smiles tonight. Not even he who loves me shall know my
great song, that, I think, and well sung. Okay. In many respects, the bushranger Darkey Gardner was unique. He was part of Ben Hall's gang, who in 1862 robbed the Lachlan Gold Escort, and he was captured eventually. And he was unique because not only did he not serve his 32-year sentence and was spared hanging, but a public campaign got him released after 10 years on condition he left the country, which he did quite happily. He went to San Francisco, where he ran the Twilight Star Saloon. So Darkey Gardner is one of the survivors amongst the bushrangers. Now, this song about him was collected by John Meredith from Ina Popplewell in 1954 in Sydney, and she was a little old lady who lived in a one-room stone house in the suburb of Darlington, near Surrey Hills, since disappeared. She had no electricity, she used an outside toilet from a nearby factory, and she had no running water in the house in 1954 in Sydney. And Meredith and Nancy Keesing went to visit her and to record her, because Nancy had been told about it from a Red Cross worker. This old lady, she knows some old songs. And they recorded 21 songs from her one afternoon, but only on the basis they went to a neighbour, because there was nowhere to plug Meredith's tape recorder. But this is the song that came out of that, and I'm really pleased we've got Roger Hargraves and Collector to sing it for us. So please welcome Roger Hargraves and Collector.
Years ago, I was listening to a lot of Planxty and Balkan music, and I did abominable things with the rhythm of this song. So Collector and I used to, Collector used to have a fair go at this. It'll either work or it won't, but this is the story. Well, Frank Gardner, he is caught at last, and he lies in Sydney jail, wounding Sergeant Middleton and robbing the Mudgee Mail. For plundering of the gold escort, the cargo mail also, and it was for gold he made so bold, and not so long ago. Surprised them all throughout the Sydney land, and on his friends he gave a call, and he quickly raised a band, and fortune always favoured him until the time of late, until Ben Hall and Gilbert met with their dreadful fate. Well, young Vaney has surrendered, Ben Hall's got his death wound, and as for Johnny Gilbert, the fine alarm was found. They was on the run, he was on the run, when the troopers came in sight. Done, wounded, ran, but the other man got slaughtered in the fight. Start that again.
Hang on.
Well, farewell adieu to outlaw Frank. He was the poor man's friend. The government has secured him for its laws he did offend. He boldly stood his trial and he answered with a breath. And do what you will, you can but kill, and I have no fear of death. Day after day they remanded him, escorted from the bar. Fresh charges brought against him from neighbours near and far. And now it is all over and the sentence they have passed, and all sought to find a verdict and guilty was at last. When lives you take are warning, boys, and a woman never trust. She will
turn round, I will be bound. We did answer first. He's due in 2 and 30 years. He's doomed to serve the crown. And well may he say he rue the day that he met with Mrs. Brown.
Great stuff. Thanks, Collector, and thank you, Roger. Now, if you read John's biography, and I hope you do, one of the names that comes up in the biography halfway through, or a bit further than halfway through, is Rob Willis. Rob is a major contributor to this festival and at the National Library. He's continuing Meredith's work, as are others, in the field, collecting their material in the Australian tradition. Rob is an amazingly important member of the Australian community of collectors. And he's certainly the heir to John Meredith. And in Meredith's final years of collecting, he collected with Rob. So I'd like Rob to introduce a couple of the songs. I want him on this stage to celebrate John's collecting. So let's also welcome Rob Willis.
Ten years on the track. I think it was the longest apprenticeship in history with John. Enjoyed every moment of it, of course, and I still don't know whether I'm qualified. We're going to talk about a couple of people that we gave to John. It was a communal thing of if someone found someone that was of interest that should be recorded, we would share it with John and John would go and record it. Carrie Milliner, we're going to be talking at the Bulch Brothers in a little while, and also Bert Jamison. Carrie Milliner, Chloe's going to do the wonderful song Bonnie Moon. And in my mind, I have when we recorded Carrie Milliner down at the Nullica in the south coast of New South Wales, the tape recording box that I wrote this on is still in the National Library. John said, she's as good as Sally, Rob, Sally Sloan. So Carrie Milliner was as good as Sally Sloan. Thanks very much, and thanks to the wonderful Rowetts for doing this song.
It was the first collected song we learnt at this National Folk Festival, a gig at the Marquee back in the 90s, and we met Rob Willis for the first time. And Rob said, I've got a song you might like, and he sent us a C90 tape. Do you remember tapes? Yeah, wind them with a pen. And we played, and Bonnie Moon was the first song, and we fell in love with Bonnie Moon. And then we heard song after song after song, a whole C90's worth of magnificent material, and we enthused to Rob on the phone, and a few days later, 7 more tapes arrived in the post.
I wandered many a night in June. Thank you.
Rob Willis is responsible for many things. Lots of them, lots of fun, but they push you into very interesting places. And this is a song that Rob also introduced us to by the Bulge Brothers. The Bulge Brothers are hilarious singers. They've actually been on this stage, I believe, but not at a festival that we were. Was anyone here that time when the Bulge Brothers ripped up the Butterwang stage at the National Folk Festival? No hands at all. David, oh, there's a couple, thank you. Was it good? Yes. That's a short conversation, wasn't it? And the Bulge Brothers sang some hilarious songs. Most of them you can't sing anymore. You know, politically correct days. It's amazing how the language and what's okay on a stage changes. I could do things on a stage that the Bulges would be horrified by, and vice versa. But this is a song we learned from them that was written by their dad, Arthur Spenlow Bulge, called their property Bugger Castle. The closest post office was Mystic Park. And so if you wanted to write a letter to Arthur Spenlow Bulge, you'd write Arthur Spenlow Bulge, Bugger Castle, Mystic Park. If you need a postcode for that address, it's a shame. And I remember probably first hearing Stewie sing this song from the Gay Charmers. It's really nice to hear Stewie again this weekend here playing his wonderful, wonderful music, singing his songs. And we'll do this one, You Can't Change It, for Stewie, because we thank him for this song.
Oh, I know a lot of lazy men, meet them when you may. They've never got a penny, always stony broke, they say. With me, it's just the other way. I'm a man of biz. I've always got a shilling in my pocket. Here it is, but I can't change it. I can't change it. The reason why, I'll let you know. It's one I made myself, and so I can't change it. I don't intend to try, but I hope to cheat a blind man in that sweet by and by.
When we first learnt this song, I knew we'd sing it all over Australia and all over the world, and I wondered about that line about, you know, someone being blind and being cheated, and, you know, how it would actually pan out when the inevitable happened. It happened pretty quick. It was in Annandale in Sydney at the wonderful Loaded Dog Folk Club, and there was a fella in the row, front row, with the cane, the dog and the glasses. And I saw Chloe, heard Chloe, I saw the line coming, and Chloe said, I hope to cheat a blind man in the sweet by and by. And the fella leant into Chloe and he said, you'd have Buckley's. I thought, we'll be right with this one.
Oh, I never was a proud man, as anyone can see. The fashions I don't care about, and clothes don't trouble me. I never was a masher, for I'm satisfied to know I've got but one shirt to me back. I can't say that, although I can't
change it, I can't change it.
I've got but one shirt to me back, and it fits me like a bloomin' sack. And I can't
change it, I don't intend to try.
'Cause while it's being washed, I lie in bed until it's dry.
That's better and better, hey?
Sorry, dear, I'd love to help you, but, you know, no shirt.
No shirt.
Well, I thought that I'd get married like a lot of foolish men.
Uh-huh.
I found the girl and bought the ring. I got married there and then. But when the job was over, well, I was down a peg. Her hair, her eyes, her teeth were false, and she had a wooden leg. But I can't
change it, I can't change it.
It was a great surprise to me, half a woman, half a tree. But I can't
change it, I don't intend to try.
I'll just chop her up for firewood in that sweet by and by.
It gets cold in Millthorpe. You do what you can. It's a lazy soul. Can't change it.
When I got home the other night, the nurse was at the door. She said, "You've got another one, and that makes you just a score. And such a pretty little girl, I hope you wish her joy." Well, I wished her to old Nick, for what I wanted was a boy. But I can't change it, I can't change it. I asked a lot who ought to know. I asked the nurse and she said,
"No.
She can't change it, she doesn't intend to try. But she hopes I'll have a dozen in that sleep by and by."
Okay, now we're running short of time, so we're going to have to be quick here, but I'm so pleased that Dave DeSanti's on the stage, because like Rob Willis, Dave DeSanti had an important part to play in the final years of Meredith's life. Dave and Rob started the Pioneer Performer Series, the Carrobity Press, and published a lot of the material which was being collected in the field in the 1990s. Dave was a driving force behind that, and he's going to play with some friends here a short bracket of tunes, because tunes were so much part of the tradition. And Rob is going to play as well, and it'll be quick, I'm sure, because I'm going to get thrown off the stage. But please welcome Dave DeSanti and friends, some tunes from Bert Jamison and Sally Sloan. Tunes are wonderful. Okay, now we've got three more songs, and next one is riddle songs. They're in tradition. They go back to the 1500s. This is a song which has its roots back at that time. It's gone through many versions. This is an Australian version collected in 1984 by John Meredith from Harry Dick's in the Western District. And I'm really pleased that we've got Cloud Street to sing it for us. They've learned the song. And then after that, they're going to sing a song, an original Meredith song. He hated cats, did Mero, but he made an exception of Trim, who was Matthew Flinders' flat. There's a statue of Trim next to the Matthew Flinders statue in Sydney. And so these two songs, Chicken Without a Bone from Harry Dix and The Ballad of Trim from Cloud Street.
This is a riddle song, but I think there may have been alcohol involved. Just have a listen, because it's a riddle song where the questions get weirder and the answers get less appropriate, and they still like each other. So I'm betting that they had a bottle between them in this one. This is The Chicken Without a Bone.
It was old Squire's daughter that lived near Narrow Lane, next door to Mr. Rubery, the keeper of the game. I'd have that maiden lie with me, but only for the law. I'd have her lie the night with me, and she'd lie next to the wall. Oh, go along, young man, she said, and do not trouble me. Before I lie the night with you, you must answer me questions three. Three questions now I put to you, and you must answer them all. Before I lie a night with you at either stock or wall. For my breakfast you must get a chicken without a bone. For my dinner you must get a cherry without a stone. For my supper you must get a bird without a gall. Then you and I in the one bed lie, and I lie next to the wall. Oh, when a chicken is in his shell, he really has no bone. And when a cherry is in full bloom, it really has no stone. The dove, she is a gentle bird, she flies without her gall. And you and I in the one bed lie, and I lie next to the wall. Oh, go along, young man, she said, and do not trouble me. Before I lie a night with you, you must answer me question six. Six questions now I put to you, and you must answer them all. Before I lie a night with you at either stock or wall. Oh, what is rounder than a ring, or higher than a tree? Oh, what is worse than womankind, or deeper than the sea? And which sings best, the truth but first, from it the dewdrops fall. And you and I in the one bed lie, and I lie next to the wall. Oh, the world is rounder than a ring, got higher than a tree. The devil's worse than womankind, hell's deeper than the sea. The bird that's best, the truth but first, from it the dewdrops fall. And you and I in the one bed lie, and I lie next to the wall. Oh, go along, young man, she said, and do not trouble me. Before I lie a night with you, you must answer me questions three. For me, you must get a winter fruit that in September grew. For me, you must get a green mantle that webbing ne'er went through. Get a sparrow's horn, a priest unborn to join us one and all. And you and I in the one bed lie, and I lie next to the wall. Oh, my father, he has the winter coat that in September grew. Me mother, she has the green mantle that webbing ne'er went through. A sparrow's horn is easy got, there's one on every claw. But a priest unborn there never was, for God he made us all. And then he folded her in his arms and laid her against the wall.
Isn't it wonderful to see so many concertinas up on stage today?
This song about Matthew Flinders' cat is very cute, and it has a chorus. Is anyone up for a sing?
Yes.
Oh, hooray. So we're going to sing the chorus twice to make sure you get a good go at it every time.
No matter
Matthew Flinders had a cat who travelled on several ships with Matt. The cat was one of that gallant band who sailed right around this great south land. With the O-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for a life on the rolling sea. With the O-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for a life on the rolling sea. He had no name, but on a sudden whim, the captain said, we'll call him Trim. On a tight little ship with sails unfurled, Matt and Trim sailed around the world. With the O-heave-ho, the wind blows free, over a life on the rolling sea. With the O-heave-ho, the wind blows free, over a life on the rolling sea. Trim was a cat with lots of spunk. He would climb the rigging and he ate salt junk. The most illustrious of his race, many were the dangers he would face. With the O-heave-ho, the wind blows free, over a life on the rolling sea. With the O-heave-ho, the wind blows free, over a life on the rolling sea. The delight and pleasure of all the crew, Trim took his meals in the forecastle too. But now and then was he was able, he also ate at the captain's table. With the yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea. With the yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea. One day poor Trim fell overboard. He'll drown, the crew all roared. They threw him a rope which he grabbed like a man. Quickly up it like a cat he ran. With the yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea. With the yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea. On the Isle de France, alas, one day, Matt and his cat were cast away. Into prison the captain went, Trim was up the country sent. With the yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea. With the yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea. The Ile de France was short of meat, the natives couldn't get enough to eat. They looked at the cat and they said, he'll do. Trim finished up in a pussycat stew. With a yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, over the life of the rolling sea. With a yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, over the life of the rolling sea. Now Trim is gone, but remembered still, on the Mitchell Library windowsill. His statue is there for all to see, under a Moreton Bay fig tree. With a yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea. With a yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea. With a yo-heave-ho, the wind blows free, oh, for the life of the rolling sea.
Great stuff, Flower Street. They've learned those songs just for this concert, and I hope they keep singing them. This concert, by the way, is about the 12th concert we've had to launch this biography of John Meredith, and it's the last. After this concert, we're going to declare the book officially launched. Folkies launch everywhere, you know this. This is the way we do it. So if you'd like to know how these songs came to be collected and the person who collected them, the book will be available at the back of the or the front of the auditorium afterwards. There's a 30-track CD comes with the book. Many of them original field recordings, the best of the field recordings, and some wonderful interpretations of the songs by some very fine singers included on that CD. So you get both the book and the CD for $35. If you'd like it, please buy it, because my publisher would really appreciate it, and so would I. We have one song to finish, and I want to say thank you to all of the people who've assisted me in the launches of this book. Not just today, but throughout the place over the last 6 months, but certainly today. And one group who has assisted me at about two other concerts, and they're going to finish the concert today for us. Can you welcome Dingo's Breakfast to sing a night visiting song that's known in different versions, Navy Boots or Shearing Boots, or this is the Shearing Boots or the Pit Boots, but it's a song collected in from Tumbarumba bloke Roy McClelland by Meredith in 1984, I think it was, Shearing Boots, and here's Dingo's Breakfast.
Thanks, Clay.
G'day.
Straight away.
One, two, three, one, two, three. Bit loud, sorry, can we have that down a bit?
That's better, thanks.
Here we go again.
Down tired and weary from shearing all day, down the road through the valley I'm making me way. By a hut in the valley I slowly passed on, just wiring me way with my shearing boots on. In the valley I slowly passed by, when from inside there came forth a cry. Oh Johnny, oh Johnny, is that you John? Oh yes, says I, with my shearing boots on. Well, she opened the door and invited me in, then into the bedroom she offered me then. Me being cold and the blankets rolled down, I slept there all night with my shearing boots on.
He slept there all night with his shearing boots on.
Now early next morning at breaking of day, I says to me true love, I must be away. Oh Johnny, oh Johnny, you know you've done wrong, you slept here all night with your shearing boots on.
He slept there all night with his shearing boots on.
Well, I rolled on me back with a laugh and a smile. How can I do wrong in such a short while? What I have done, it was all done in fun. I'd do it again with my shearing boots on. Six months or later, 7 months at most, this pretty young damsel grew thick round the waist. 8 months later and 9 months and on, she's brought forth two sons with her shearing boots on.
She brought two sons with her shearing boots on.
Not one son, but two with her shearing boots on.
Can you just give one hand to the performers of this concert today? Danny Spooner, Lucy Wise Trio, Alex Hood, Pam Merrigan, Bruce Watson, Christine Wheeler and Friends, Roger Hargraves and Collector, Rob Willis, Chloe and Jason, Dave DeSanti, Cloud Street and Dingo's Breakfast. They've done a wonderful job. Enjoy the festival. And the book will be available at the front.